Hello, everybody. This is Alex Merced from alexmerced.com. And today I want to talk about is family formation. Because I always hear different social scholars, political scholars mention statistics regarding family formation. Now, what these statistics typically find is that there is a correlation between poverty and the size of a household. So basically, bottom line is, oftentimes you'll see two-parent households better off than single-parent households. And there's different ways, and again, that's just a correlation. Correlation does not mean causation. So typically the way the causation is argued, especially on the right, sort of the, well, I guess what we would consider the pro-family side of things, and I'm pro-family, okay, and I'll come back to that. They'll argue that the reason that correlation exists, which I think there is some truth to, is that when you have multiple people in the same household, they focus on a two-parent household, but I'm just saying, if you have multiple people in the same household, there's more people to share the household responsibilities with, whether it's just cleaning, helping the kids with homework, all these things that happen in the household. If there's more than one person there to help out with all of that, it can get done, and it can get done better. Also lightens the stress in doing all of that, which sometimes stress and pressure and frustration can lead to people not necessarily being as nice as they would like to their children. So that's all fine and good. Yes. And also, again, multiple incomes in the same household help as well. But I don't think that causation only runs that way as well, although I think that's totally plausible, totally makes sense. But I also think the causation runs the other way around, that oftentimes families that don't stay together, maybe because of poverty, it is harder to maintain a relationship that is in sort of perpetual poverty, okay? And sometimes it could be the relationship itself that is contributing to that perpetual poverty. It may that you can have couples who are codependent, who basically enable each other to make to continue bad habits that prevent themselves from moving forward and improving their stake. And anecdotally, I always point out to my situation where basically when my parents together, we were much worse off than when they were separately. So basically while they were together, we were in abject poverty. It wasn't pretty. It was a toxic relationship for a variety of reasons. But the fact when they separated, they both changed their habits, they changed, made different decisions that both led them to having a much higher quality of life, better economic outcomes, etc. Okay, so in some parts, the relationship was what contributed to the economic state prior to them ending the relationship. So in some cases, if you have a toxic household, it's better that that household breaks. This is what I'm saying you want good household, good healthy households to form and to stay together. Yes, I am all for that. I want healthy families with people who get along, people who complement each other and make each other better, who love their kids, who form a supportive household for children. And I don't care about the makeup of that household. It doesn't have, so people always focus on the makeup of man and woman, two parents. I don't care. What I care about is as many people being in a child's life that love that child. And people who complement each other, again, they support each other, they encourage each other, they make each other better. That's a healthy household, regardless of whether it's a mother and her siblings, you know, two men, two women, a gaggle of people, in whatever type of arrangement that they wish. What matters is that social dynamic of love, support, encouragement, etc. Okay, because basically kids have to be told that they can accomplish things, that they need to work, that they need to respect others. And there has to be people who sort of display that and for them to emulate. So that's a good thing. But having a two-parent household, for the sake of having a two-parent household, encouraging two parents to stay together when the relationship is toxic and sets a bad example for the child, that to me is counterproductive. Okay? So in the sense, a lot of people point to divorce rates as sort of this huge deal, like, oh, there's so many more divorces. This is a sign of people just, you know, not wanting to form families. And I think there's a lot more to it than that, in the sense that, one, the reason why there's more divorces is mainly because the social stigma of getting divorced has changed. But that also means toxic relationships don't necessarily persist as much. And that means people can find better relationships where they can form better households, and that's a good thing. So if they get it right on their second marriage, third marriage, fourth marriage, whatever, but if they get it right, children will be better off. And again, I speak to my own example, where I adore my father and mother, and I adore the people that they've become and the lives that they've been able to build for themselves, but they had to do it separately. And other things that also people are just not getting married as early in life, they're getting married later in life, some people are choosing not to get married, at least not formally married, doesn't necessarily mean they're not making a marriage-like commitment to each other, but bottom line is, it's just sort of these norms of how you define your relationship and what a relationship means have changed, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. It doesn't change the dynamics or what value, what people care about in a household, meaning love, support, encouragement, education, those kind of things. But bottom line is, yes, an economically better off household is more likely to be more cohesive, which is again arguing it the other way around and saying that the likeliness of a household to stay together may be based on where it is already economically, versus then saying where it is economically will be determined by the shape of the household. I can see the argument both ways. It's probably a combination of both. But if you only see it one way or the other way, it can have some very dangerous policy implications of where you're trying to push people to do one thing or the other. I don't want people to be pushed to stay in a marriage, but I don't want people to be pushed to divorce either. And we do have that as well, where there are policies that create incentives that reward people for breaking up their household, in a sense. They create, even if it's only on the margins, economic incentives to have a separate household, even if the relationship does work. Policy should be more neutral on the shape, size, form of a household. What people should care about, again, is love, encouragement, support, respect, those kind of things. And I think we'll do much better by children than a lot of the things that we may focus on now and hyper-focus on minutiae that doesn't necessarily make as much a difference as things that do make a difference. So my name is Alex Merced from alexmerced.com. Have a great day and enjoy.